Jesus is his name.
Sure is good to see everybody this morning. I'd like to welcome everybody, especially like to welcome those that's joined us online. If we would just now, let's go ahead and stand for our call to worship. Our call to worship this morning comes out of Colossians, chapter 1, verses 19 and 20. And it says this, "For it has pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell, and having made peace through the blood of his cross by him, to reconcile all things unto himself by him, I say whether they be things in earth or things in heaven." Join me in prayer, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we just praise your name for being here today. We just praise you for another beautiful day, another opportunity to be with brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we've already experienced you in our midst, and we praise you for that. We thank you for each and every conversation I heard this morning, just the love that is shared here, Lord, and we know it's all because of you. And Lord, our prayer this morning is that, Lord, that we don't stay the same, that we grow closer to you each day, and we become more like you. Lord, forgive us for the times we fall short. And our prayer this morning is you touch Pastor Mark, Lord, his health, keep him strong, and allow him to deliver the message that you have him prepared for. And Lord, that will stir our hearts and draw us closer to you. Lord, our prayer is that if anybody would be in the listening area, Lord, we just pray that this will touch their hearts and they'll draw closer to you and give their life to you if they don't know you. They turn their life over to you for that eternal salvation. And Lord, we just praise you for all things, and we just pray that everything that's done here this morning will glorify you the way you so richly deserve. Lord, we also pray for the different individuals that couldn't be here this morning, whatever the reason may be, whether it be physical or other obligations. Lord, we just pray that you be in their midst and allow them to know that you really realize that you do love them. Now just watch over us, protect us, and keep us safe, and bless this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
See, on the hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free. Look at the wounds that give me life, grace flowing from his side, no greater sacrifice. What he's done, what he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done. Sing for the freedom He has won. Even death is dead and done. His life has overcome. Speak, say the name of the Lord. Over every broken face, He is risen from the grave. Future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done. Now, on a throne of majesty, the Father's will comes sing. He reigns in victory.
See everybody this morning, by the way. Everybody doing well? Yeah, well, you always know you're kind of in for it, or you never know what you're going to get when you have these two right here sitting side by side. Okay? Everybody, I know you're looking at him like, but that's our pastor. And that's one of our deacons, Gary. Yeah, it is. Stand up here for just one day. Ask Lynn Stoniger. Here from the back, yeah. Hey, aren't you glad that we have joy in Christ? Amen. Amen. Chris prayed earlier that he's just glad to be here to worship with his brothers and sisters. I'm glad to see you. Are you glad to see everyone else? Amen. Amen. Good, because we're going to celebrate one glorious day together. One day we're going to be celebrating every day together. Amen. No more tears, no more pain. Until that time, we worship and thank Him for what He's done while we're here. And we celebrate the glorious day right now as we sing, okay?
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb. Till I met You, I was breathing the night alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my doom. Till I met You. You called my name.
Nothing blesses your heart more anymore than knowing one glorious day will be with him, and also to watch a mom holding her child praising the Lord. Amen. Outpost kindergarten through fifth grade, go have a great morning worship choir. You're dismissed. Everyone else, welcome someone around you. Celebrate his glorious day of worship today.
Sufficient merit shining like the sun, a fortune I inherit by no work I have done. My righteousness I forfeit at my Savior's cross, where all what I could not.
is done. It is finished. Amen. Take a moment and thank Him for that right now. Just you and Jesus. Bow your heads. Lord, from the beginning, You were planning for a task that only You could complete. You were training. You were teaching. You were learning to be all that Your Father wanted You to be. No one but You could have been the sacrifice for us. You did it humbly, without reservation. You did it beautifully and with love. Obediently. Thank You for Your gift, Your sacrifice, Your victory through the cross. Lord, I pray this morning that someone can leave this place saying that they're clean, that they're forgiven. Satan's going to try and beat down Pastor Mark this morning with his voice. Make him strong. Let the words knock down that final piece that will not separate someone from Your Son Jesus, but that will give them the opportunity to respond and give them freedom, joy, and the eternal promise of heaven. So guide him through Your word, strengthen his voice, open our ears and our hearts and our minds in this place this morning. And again, thank You for the cross. Thank You for loving us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Good morning. It is absolutely good to be here this morning. It's good to be up here this morning. It really is. And it's good to have a voice. Last 2 weeks, well, actually the last 3 weeks, I've had no voice whatsoever. And it's still not back to where, you know, it should be. So you pray for me this morning that, because it seems like the longer I go, the worse it gets. So we're hoping that we'll get through it. I've sucked down every kind of cough drop that has been made in the world. I'm telling you right now. And, you know, I thought it's kind of like this, this little boy. The preacher was preaching and he'd had problems with it, with his voice as well. And you know, he said, he told the congregation that I've got this cough drop, and he said, whenever I'm going to preach until that cough drop's done, is gone. When the cough drop is gone, then I'm done with the sermon, I'm finished preaching. The little boy leaned over his mom and he said, Mom, he said, I sure hope he doesn't get a button in his mouth. Now there have been rumors this past week that since I haven't preached for 2 weeks, that, who said uh-oh? Uh-huh. Already, it's already started. That since I haven't got to preach the last 2 Sundays, that today could be very long. It's all rumors. Trust me, it's all rumors. And but I appreciate. I come in this morning and Gary Tedder looks at me and says, "Well, it's nice to see you got Pastor Rick's clothes on." Now you had to be here Sunday night to know what that means. That last Sunday night, you had to know what that means. Rick came in. Rick preached last Sunday morning for me, and he came in. He had jacket and, you know, dress clothes on, all that stuff. A little boy walked up to him and said, "Why are you wearing Pastor Mark's clothes?" So I've got Rick's clothes on this morning, according to Gary Tedder. Galatians chapter 6 It's what we want to look at. And, you know, we are moving toward that time when the cross is really really celebrated as we move toward Easter. The cross, we begin to look at the cross a little bit more in depth and a little bit more in detail. You know, we should always look at the cross. Listen, I want to tell you something. The cross, for us today, we look back at the cross. The Old Testament saints, they look forward to the cross. A lot of people ask me, they'll say, how did people in the Old Testament, how did they get saved? Same way we do, by putting their faith in God. God was manifested in His Son, Jesus Christ. And so we have the privilege of looking back on the cross and the finished work of Jesus on that cross. And so we celebrate the cross in that way as we look back at it. Yes, it's an instrument of death, a very cruel death that people experienced on the cross. But it also signifies to us a God that loves us so very, very much that He was willing to take our sin upon Himself and to pay the penalty for that sin. See, there's consequences to sin. And there is always a price to pay when it comes to sin in our lives. There's always a price to pay. The Bible talks about how people enjoy the pleasures of sin. It's just for a season. But there's always a penalty, and there's always a consequence to sin. Certainly, before we know Jesus as our Savior, but even as Christians, as Christians, whenever a Christian sins, there's consequences to that, and there's penalties to that, and there's no way around that. But here we have an all righteous God taking our sin upon Himself and dying upon the cross, giving us the opportunity, giving us the potential to experience forgiveness of our sin. Because in order, there's nothing that's defiled that's going to go into heaven. It's just that simple. Nothing that's defiled. Nothing that defiles will enter there. The Scripture teaches us very plainly. And so that means that we have to have our sin issue taken care of. And there's only one way that sin issue can be taken care of. And that's through the blood of Jesus Christ. The blood of Christ that cleanses us. John wrote in 1 John 1:7, and he said, if we have fellowship one with another, the blood of Jesus Christ, if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. From all sin. So that's the ticket. That's the remedy for this sin issue that everybody is born with. Everybody. And that is the blood of Jesus Christ that can and will cleanse from all of our sin. And people will say, and I've heard this down the last 40-some years that I've been in ministry now, people will say, they'll say, Pastor, you don't know what I've done in my life, you don't know where I've been, you don't know what I've been involved in, you know, and all this type of thing. How could God forgive me? The Bible is very plain in that it says that where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. There's no sin that is more powerful than the blood of Christ. There is no sin that the blood of Christ cannot cleanse. And there is nothing that He is unwilling to forgive you and to cleanse me from. And so we celebrate the cross. And that's what I want us to think about today as we begin our journey with the cross. Did you read the quote by Martin Luther? He said this: no man understands the Scriptures unless he's acquainted with the cross. No man understands the Scriptures unless he's acquainted with the cross. So all of us, for everybody that wants to follow God, for everybody that wants to go to heaven when this life is over, when their life is over, and who would pick hell over heaven? That's just beyond me. Why would somebody pick hell over heaven? where the fire is not quenched, where the smoke of their torment rises up forever. That's not my philosophy. That's Scripture. That's the Word of God. That's what the Word of God says. The smoke of their torment ascends up forever, where the fire is not quenched, the worm dies not, and the fire is not quenched. Who in their right mind would pick that over heaven? Who would do that? Well, sadly, there are a lot are. But the reality is, if you want to go to heaven when your life on earth has come to an end, and it will come to an end, because the Bible is very plain about that. The Bible teaches us plainly that for it's appointed unto men once to die, and then after this, the judgment. It's going to happen. They used to talk about, you know, two sure things in life, death and taxes, right? Well, that's, you know, the reality is taxes is not a sure thing. Half the people in this country don't pay taxes. Do you know that? It's the truth. Half of the people in this country don't pay taxes, so we take care of them, all right? But the reality is there are two things that are sure in this life, death and judgment. Those are the two things that are sure. So if you want to go to heaven and you want to hear the words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into the joys of the Lord," you've got to go by the cross. You've got to become acquainted with the cross. You have got to go by the cross of Jesus Christ. So how do we get there? That's what I want us to look at this morning. I want us to look at it biblically from kind of start to finish, so to speak. And we're going to take that journey today. And God is going to help us get there. The Word of God is going to help us get there, all right? So in Galatians, it's no wonder that Paul would write these words in Galatians 6:14. He would say this, "But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me and I unto the world." Let me read that again. "But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross." So we glory in the cross. While the world used it as a cruel instrument of death, we glory in it. Because it was there, God's Son paid the price and the penalty, paid the ransom for our sins. He was the ransom that brought us back, that could bring us back into favor with God, that could bring us back into communion with God, in harmony with God. Sin separates communion with God. Sin separates harmony with God. The cross serves as the instrument of reconciliation that brings us back into harmony, that brings us back into communion with God. So Paul says, I glory in the cross. The fact of the matter is, because it's the only way. It is the only way that we can come back to the point to where we are accepted by God. It's through His cross and the cleansing. Now, I don't worship the cross. I praise God for the cross. I thank Him for the cross. I worship the man on the cross. I worship Jesus Christ, not the cross. But the cross was the vehicle through which God would extend to us the opportunity to experience this forgiveness. So I'm going to read it one more time. Let it settle in. But God forbid that I should glory, in anything else, that I should glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me and I unto the world. It's no wonder that Paul would say these words, Galatians 2:20. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live in the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I am crucified with Christ. See, the reality is, if you are a believer, if you are a Christian, you had to go by the cross. You had to say, you have to say with Paul those very same words, I am crucified with Christ. I am crucified with Christ. So how do we get to this point? How do we get to the place that we get to the cross? Well, four main points, a few little sub points, but four this morning. And the first one is that, listen, God will lead us there. God will take you to the cross. He will lead us there. Now, how does God lead us to the cross? Well, it started back in the garden. First of all, God will lead us there through prophecy. Through prophecy. I personally believe that the first messianic prophecy, or the first prophecy that tells about the coming Messiah, and that's what a messianic prophecy is. It's God telling the world that there is a Messiah that's going to come. And I personally believe that the first messianic prophecy is found in the book of Genesis, in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. And it says this. Now here, you know the story of Adam and Eve. You know the story of the serpent. You know the story of their willful disobedience against the instructions of God concerning the tree that was in the center of the garden. All right? Now he says this in Genesis 3:15, first messianic prophecy. He says this, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. You say, what in the world, how in the world is that a prophecy concerning Jesus Christ? Now let me remind you of what a prophet is. Now in this instance, God himself is speaking. But down through time, God has given the message that a Messiah was coming through his prophets. Now remember, a prophet was God's representative to man. This is the one that God would use to deliver his message to mankind, what he wanted man to know. A priest was different from a prophet in that a priest was man's representative to God. The priest would go to God on man's behalf, whereas a prophet would go to man on God's behalf. Okay? So it's completely, completely different. God is, in this instance, God himself is giving this message about the coming of the Messiah. The message starts concerning the Messiah. The message starts with a sentencing upon the serpent. A sentencing upon Satan is where the message starts. First of all, he says to him that you're going to move from being beautiful and subtle. Remember, the serpent was the most subtle beast, the most beautiful beast in the garden whenever he came. But now we see that all of that changes, because now the serpent goes from being the most subtle and the most beautiful creature in the garden to literally slithering on the ground and eating dust. The serpent then, the sentencing continues, because he says, I will put enmity, there will be strife, and there will be hatred that occurs between you. So he moves from between you and and Adam and Eve. So it moves from hostility. The serpent moves from moves to hostility and hatred, not friendship. Hostility and hatred, not friendship, will be between the serpent, now get this, between the serpent and the woman. All right? And we're going to get to just a little bit more on this. James 4:4 gives us an indication as James speaks to us today. He says this. He says, "You adulterers and adulteresses, know you not that friendship of the world is enmity with God?" Now notice, one of the sentences upon Satan in the garden was, "I will put enmity between you and the woman. I will put this hostility, I will put this hatred, if you would, between the two of you." He says, "Know you not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God." Now Jesus was saying in the Sermon on the Mount, no man can serve two masters, for he'll love one, hate the other. He'll cling to one, despise the other. You can't serve God and mammon. You can't serve God and the world. You can't do it. It just cannot happen. That's why if you're here today and you're dabbling in the world and holding on to, Jesus got you by the other hand and the other hand is in the world, you're in a very precarious situation. You're in a tough spot. All right? You're in a no-win situation, to be perfectly honest with you. Okay? Now, so Satan, from the most beautiful, most subtle creature in the garden that was subtle enough to deceive Adam and Eve, to deceive them, he goes from that to being at hostility and hatred, not friendship. You know that day that he deceived Eve and Adam, that day he presented himself as the best friend that they could have. He presented himself as looking out for their welfare. He presented himself in a way that they could trust him. He presented himself in a way that they would listen to him. He presented himself as such a caring and only concerned with their welfare. He presented himself in such a way that they say, "I like your idea. I like your idea. I like your idea whenever you tell us that God did not say you shall die. God knew that in the moment that you eat the fruit, that your eyes will be open and that you will be like him." I like that idea. I don't like so much the other idea that God said, if you eat of the fruit of the garden, you will surely die. I don't like that so much. I like your idea better. You see, the craftiness and the subtleness of Satan hasn't changed. He uses the same methods today. He convinces people today that he's the best friend they've got. He convinces people today that his way is far better than God's way. His way is far more fun than God's way. He still operates in that same way. How many of you in this room have found yourself in a situation and you thought to yourself, "Why in the world did I do this? Why in the world? Look at the mess I'm in." Have you ever thought that? I have. Many times. I thought, "How in the world did I get in this mess?" I'll tell you how you got in that mess. Because the subtleness of Satan convinced you that his way was better than God's way. His way was more fun than God's way. His way was superior to God's way. His way allows you to find yourself, to express yourself, to live, to have it your way. That's what Satan does. It's exactly what he does. It's just that simple. "I know what I'm doing." What's the famous last words of the redneck? "Hey, y'all, watch this." Right? Yeah. That's just, this is what we do. I want you to notice something that's very, very important that a lot of time in this verse that is very, very important. If we go back to Genesis 3:15, Pam, I want you to notice something that's very, very important. He says this, I will put enmity between thee and the woman. Now listen to this. Between thy seed and her seed. Now anytime you, listen, anytime in the scripture, whenever you're reading about procreation, you're reading about this, those that will follow you, it always talks about the seed of man. The seed of man. In this instance, he says, between thy seed and her seed. Now what's the big deal about that? That is a big, big deal. And this is the first time that we began to get a hint about the virgin birth. It wasn't between thy seed and his seed, but it's between thy seed and her seed. And now we're seeing God is beginning to lay out his plan that Messiah would come through a virgin. Her seed. That is super significant in this verse, and it's super significant for us. The last part of his sentencing is simply, it shall bruise thy head. In other words, you're going to be crushed. That word, bruise, comes from the Hebrew word, shuf, and it simply means crushed. It means struck out, to gape upon, to rail upon. But the bottom, the basic root meaning of that word is crush. So he looks and he says, this seed that is born of the woman, the virgin birth, this seed is going to crush your head. Now he's going to be bruised. And we look at the cross and we look at the death of Jesus. We look at what he experienced in his journey to the cross. And he was most certainly bruised, wasn't he? Most certainly bruised. And while Jesus was bruised en route to the cross and ultimately died physically upon the cross, it was the crushing blow to Satan. It was the ultimate bruising. It was the ultimate crushing. And then 3 days later, whenever Jesus arose out of the grave, then the bruising and the crushing was finalized. Now we know that later on that Satan is going to be bound for 1,000 years. We know that he's going to be chained and he's going to be bound 1,000 years during the rule of righteousness, the reign of righteousness. But at the end of that, he is going to be cast into the lake of fire, which is the final portion of his sentencing. So when we look at this, when we look at the cross, as we begin to journey in our journey to the cross, we've got to understand the root of it and really why the cross even came into existence. It came into existence in order that God might provide a way for Satan to be crushed and for you and I to experience redemption and salvation through the releasing of the blood of Jesus Christ, which cleanses us again, 1 John 1:7, which cleanses us from all our sin. Thank God, literally, thank God for the cross. Thank Him for the cross. Now, God will lead us there through prophecy, but God will also lead us there through a detailed map. A detailed map. Okay? Has anyone ever given you directions using landmarks? This before GPS. You remember what that was like? I tell you what you do. You go down this road, about half mile, and you'll see four mailboxes on the right. Now there's a road right across from them four mailboxes, and you turn left onto that road, and you travel on that road, and you'll just go a little bit down the road, and there's a big red barn on the right-hand side, and you turn right beside that barn and go down that lane, and you'll come to a two-story white house, and right there's where you want to go. Anybody ever got directions like that?
Yeah. The fact of the matter is, sometimes them directions is better than GPS directions, believe you me.
But have you ever gotten directions like that? I think we all have. If you've lived in West Virginia, you've got directions like that. All right? Me and a buddy of mine went to buy some cattle one time, and I won't tell you where at, but everybody we ran into that day was drunk. Now, we got some dandy directions. I'm telling you right now. We got directions that are so good, we had to go back the next day. Yeah. But the cross is the landmark. The landmark that God uses, that draws us, that begins to bring us to the place of redemption, to the place of forgiveness, the place of love, the place of grace. The cross is that landmark that God uses. Now, the bruising of the seed of woman is prophesied. And that bruising that we read about earlier occurred through the instrument called the cross. Now, and we're going to go, and this is a really good chapter, and I really want to encourage you, turn in your Bibles right to there right now, Psalms 22. Psalms 22, okay? And I really want to encourage you sometime this week to read that entire chapter, the entire chapter of Psalms 22, and understand while you're reading it, understand that God, this is the roadmap that God is using to talk about the bruising of Jesus and the crushing, if you would, of Satan. Okay? Now, we're not going to read the entire chapter. We're just going to read just a few selected verses out of Psalms 22. In fact, we're going to look at the very first verse. Psalms 22:1 says this, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Wait just a second. Wait. That's what Jesus said from the cross. Yeah, that's right. That's exactly right. So in Psalms 22, what we're going to read and what we're going to see in that chapter, what God has prophesied and what God gave us that would create a confirmation and an affirmation of what He told us. What He told us was true. What He told us that was coming in the form of the cross really has come. It really did occur. So here we go. Psalms 22:1. He says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Now, flip over. You can jot this down. And listen, if you want to write in your Bible, it's okay. Okay? And I'm going to tell you something. Coming to church without your Bible is like going hunting without the gun. Doesn't make much sense. All right? So, beside of Psalms 22:1, Just jot down Matthew 27:46. Now you've got them in your notes, I believe. All right? Look at this. In about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice. Jesus cried with a loud voice saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Sorry. That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Isn't it amazing that God, in Psalms 22:1, that God would give us the very words. Not the idea, but God would give us the very words that Jesus was going to speak from the cross. Now, again, drop on down a little further to Psalms 22. We're going to read verses 7 and 13. Verse 7 says this, "All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip. They shake the head." Verse 13. "They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and a roaring lion." Now look in Mark 15:31. "Likewise, also the chief priest, mocking, said among themselves with the scribes, 'He saved others, himself he cannot save.'" Again, the mocking that was prophesied, that was spoken, that Jesus would experience in Psalms 22, we see that experience happening in Mark 15:31. Look in Psalms 22:14. "I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels." Now John 19:34 says this, "But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water." Do you remember whenever the centurion came? One of the things that they would do with victims of crucifixion was that the centurions would come and they would look at them hanging on the cross, and they would take a long staff and they would break their legs. They would break their legs. And the reason that they broke their legs was so they could not push up in order to get a breath. That's the reason they broke their legs. See, one of the things that people dying on a cross, they really died of asphyxiation, is what they died of. Because whenever the weight of their body would drop and their hands were nailed or tied to the cross member of the cross beam of the cross, whenever they would do that, the shoulder blades, the clavicles of the shoulder blades, they would collapse and they would cut off all their breathing whatsoever. And literally they would die of asphyxiation. And so in order to prevent, in order for that to occur, what the centurion would come and they would break their legs so that they could not push up to catch a breath. And then they would suffocate. They would suffocate. They'd die by suffocation, you see. When they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead, and they did not break his legs. They didn't break his legs. Because the Bible teaches us that in prophesying the death of Jesus, it said that there would not be a bone in his body that was broken. And so when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead, that he had already suffocated, and so there was no need to break his legs, thereby again fulfilling prophecy about his no bones having been broken. But they were out of joint. And whenever the soldier ran the spear into his side, it went up through the lungs, it went into the heart, and all of the fluid began to drain out of him. So we see that occurring. Now, Psalms 22:16, it says this, "For dogs have compassed me, the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me." Listen, look at this. "They pierced my hands and my feet." They pierced my hands and my feet. John 20:25 says this, "The other disciples therefore said unto him," this is after resurrection, "We have seen the Lord," he's talking to Thomas, But he said unto them, except I see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger in the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. We know that Jesus then appeared, and Jesus looked at Thomas, and he said, put your hand in my side. Put your hand in my hands, in the prints of my hands. One more passage. And that's Psalms 22:18. Psalms 22:18 says this: they part my garments among them, and cast lots upon my vesture. John 19:24 says this: they said therefore among themselves, the Roman centurions, let us not rend it. You see, the coat that he wore, the garment that he wore, was singularly woven. It was one piece. It wasn't sewn together. It wasn't pieced together. It was singularly woven, a woven garment. He said, let's not rend it, but let's cast lots for it. Whose it shall be? That the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, they parted my raiment among them, and for my vesture they did cast lots. These things, therefore, the soldiers did. When we look at this, Jesus, God, in Psalms 22, and again, now I hope you have an understanding why I want you to read that entire chapter. Okay? That entire chapter of Psalms 22. All right? God gives us a detailed map in Psalms 22 as to the cross and how to get to the cross. Now, the third thing is this, and that is prophecy. Prophecy is completed. How does God lead us there? Prophecy is completed. In Mark 15, beginning at verse 16, it says, and the soldiers led him away into the hall called Praetorium, and they called together the whole band. And they clothed him with purple and plaited a crown of thorns and put it upon his head and began to salute him. Hail, King of the Jews. They smote him on the head with a reed and did spit upon him, bowing their knees, worshipped him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple from him and put his own clothes on him, and they led him out to crucify him. Everything that God said in Psalms 22 and at many other places throughout the Old Testament, there's many messianic prophecies throughout the Old Testament. Everything that God prophesied in the Old Testament was fulfilled in Jesus going to the cross and dying upon the cross. So whenever you look at the cross and you hear lessons, you hear messages, you hear teaching on the cross, understand that it's true. Understand that it is. And let me just say one more thing before we look at the last point on this. Let me say one more thing. Everything that God prophesied in the Old Testament concerning the coming of Messiah and what he would experience on this earth came true. Understand this. Everything else that God says that will happen in the future is going to happen. It's going to happen. And so we need to understand that. We need to understand that all people are going to stand before God. We understand that when the Bible says in Romans, so then every one of us shall give an account for himself, you understand that's going to happen. That's going to happen. Understand that whenever God talks about the judgment seat of Christ, whenever all believers, all Christians will stand before Jesus, and it will be Jesus that people stand before. The Bible's very plain in its teaching on this. It says very, very plainly that the Father has committed all judgment into the hands of the Son. So this God, this Messiah that was prophesied throughout the Old Testament, and the prophecy was fulfilled in the New Testament in his death and resurrection and everything else about his life that was prophesied that came true, so is this going to come true as well. The Father has committed all judgment into the hands of the Son. And there will come a time when everybody who says they are Christian will stand before Jesus at the judgment seat of Christ, the Bema seat, will stand before Jesus at the judgment seat of Christ and will there give an account for their works after they have received Jesus as Savior and Lord. Some of those works, they'll be tried by fire. Some of those works will be found to be like hay, wood, and stubble. They'll burn up. Some of those works will be found to be like precious metals, gold and silver, that's only purified by the fire. But you rest well assured that every Christian that's in this room right now, this day, is going to stand before Jesus at the judgment seat of Christ. Also understand, you think the way that you're living your life now isn't important? You think it doesn't matter? Well, I got saved. That's all I need. You better think again, my friends. You better think again. Because not only is that going to happen, is that judgment going to happen, but there's also going to be a judgment that is called the Great White Throne Judgment. And the Great White Throne Judgment is that place where unbelievers will stand before Jesus again. And Matthew, Jesus talks about it in Matthew 7. You know, he talks about it. In fact, there's going to be a lot of people who say that they're Christian that's going to end up there. Just because you say you're a Christian. Listen, just because you're born in a barn doesn't make you a cow. Going to church don't make you a Christian. That's what a person does after they become a Christian. They come and they worship and serve and fellowship. They do all of those things after they're born again. Because Jesus himself said, in that day there'll be many that say unto me, in that day, talking about this judgment, says, in that day there'll be many that will say unto me, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out demons in your name? Have we not done many great and wonderful works in your name? And Jesus looks at them and says, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. I never knew you. In other words, Jesus looks at those that did all that churchy stuff, that did all that religious stuff. He looks at them and he says, I don't know who you are. Check it out in Matthew 7, you don't believe me. 22, 23, 24, right in there. Check it out. That's a sad day. That's a sad time. Because the Bible says that that great white throne judgment, the books are open, and then every man was judged according to their works. But it says this, and whosoever's name was not found written in the Lamb's book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So there's two things that are absolutely certain in this life: death and judgment. It's going to happen, and it's going to happen to everybody. The key is that you find yourself at the judgment seat of Christ. And not the great white throne judgment. If you find yourself at the great white throne judgment, you've missed it. You've blown it. It's over. That's why the journey to the cross is absolutely vital. That's why Martin Luther would say, no man understands the scriptures unless he's acquainted with the cross. Are you acquainted with the cross? Have you made the journey to the cross? The place of forgiveness, the place of grace, the place of love, the place of mercy. The place of cleansing. Have you went there? Well, I'm a good person. That's not a journey to the cross. I'm a good husband. I don't come home and spit in the floor, kick the dog, slap the wife. I'm a good person. That's not the cross. I'm a good wife. I'm a good mom. I take care of my family. I feed my family. I go to the PTA meetings. The most excruciating thing in the world. That's not a journey to the cross. That's not the cross. I helped my community. I gave money to send those boys to Charleston. I bought them a meal. I coached for free. I do this, I do that, I do all this stuff. It's not the cross. It's not the cross. Amen or oh me. You see? The cross. Last thing is this, we're wrapping it up. Some of you are going, whew. And that is, we still glory in the cross. Folks, I'll never stop glorying in the cross. And neither should you that have been to the cross. That have actually seen what Jesus did for you there. Paul wrote to the folks at Ephesus in Ephesians, in the first chapter of Ephesians, verses 6 and 7, he says this, to the praise of the glory of His grace, wherein He has made us, get this, wherein He has made us accepted in the Beloved. Folks, the fact of the matter is, if you want to be accepted in the Beloved, you gotta go through the cross. That's the work that God accepts. He goes on to say this, and listen to this. In whom? Talking about Jesus, not talking about the cross. Talking about Jesus. In whom we have redemption through His blood. The cross was the instrument that was used to release that life-giving blood of the Lamb of God. The cross. I know I share this every year, and you might get tired of it. One of my pet peeves is people who talk about how that Jesus spilt His blood. They write it in songs. Jesus spilled His blood. I'm going to tell you something. Jesus didn't spill anything. Jesus intentionally shed His blood for our cleansing. No accident. A spill is an accident. No accident in what Jesus did for you. No accident. What He did for you and for me was intentional. And it was because He loves you more than anything in this world. You. You turn to somebody sitting beside you, you look at them and you say, He loves you. It is God's plan for our redemption. It is God's plan for our redemption. We'll back up here. Pam, I know I didn't give this to you. 1 Corinthians 1:18. It says this. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. There it is. But unto us who are saved, it is the power of God. For the preaching of the cross to them that perish is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. My question to you this morning, so are you making the journey to the cross? Have you made the journey to the cross? Do you need to make that journey to the cross today? Do you need to make that journey to the cross? I will tell you this morning by the authority of the Word of God, that if you make that journey to the cross, the Bible teaches us plainly that all that come unto Him, He will in no wise cast out. In other words, you can be accepted in the Beloved. He will not cast you aside. He will not turn you away. He will, with open arms, invite you to come to Him. Father, thank You for the morning. Thank You for allowing us to be in this place. And oh my God, how we thank You for the cross. And even more than that, how we thank You for Jesus. And I pray that everybody in this place has made that journey to the cross. How that everybody in this room can say with full assurance, I've been to the cross. And there, I found Jesus. There, I found redemption. There, I found salvation. There, I found forgiveness. There, I found cleansing. I pray that everybody in this room can make that statement. But God, if there's any that can't, help them to understand that there's no other way for redemption, for salvation, to be restored and reconciled with God. There's no other way other than through the cross. And may they purpose in their heart today and say, I want the cross. I want Jesus and what He did on the cross for me. God, I pray for Christians that You give us burdens for the lost, that we might not just point people to the cross, but we might lead people to Jesus. We might lead people to that place where that they can experience forgiveness and cleansing. Move among us is our prayer. Amen. Stand with us. We're going to sing. We invite you. If you want to come and pray for someone, you come and pray for them. If you need to give your life to Jesus, give your life to Jesus today. If you want to go to heaven, if you want to follow God, if you want to be reconciled, brought back into favor with God, I'm telling you right now, you got to go by the cross. You got to go by the cross. So let's do it.
I will kneel in the dust at the foot of the cross, where mercy paid for me, where the wrath I deserve, it is gone and has passed. Your blood has hidden me. Thank you.
This is not the time to be thinking about it. This is the time to take action. Not to just think about it. This is the time to pray for those folks you love. This is the time. Not just thinking about it. What mercy. We're all the recipients of that mercy. Every one of us in this place. Thank God for mercy. Amen. Man, thank God for mercy. Amen. 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 If you ever have days, and we all do, I guess, on occasion, you ever have a day, you ever have a time, when you feel like nobody loves you or nobody cares about you or you're all alone, or I don't know how I'm going to get through this, What I can do. Look at the cross. Just look at the cross. And you'll see the greatest manifestation of love and grace and mercy from God Himself. Amen. Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for the cross. Amen. I am thankful. Amen.
Amen.
I am. Go to worship with our tithes and offerings right now. And I don't know what else.